So, hello, it's 18 or 6 p.m. and 1 minute, so I just will wait for another 2 or 3 minutes. After that, I will start the webinar. Today's content will be the color checker workflow here in Capture One. And of course, I will also demonstrate how to work with Capture One and how to go the extra mile outside of Capture One. We leave the raw workflow and go into the pixel-based workflow with Affinity Photo and all just around the color thing. Okay, so if you have any questions or if you want to show me some stuff, just write into the chat or into the questions pod you have here with the GoToWebinar software. So just feel free and write questions if you have some. Okay, so just a small introduction to myself. My name is Martin Dörsch. I'm from Austria. If you want to have more information about me, you can go over to my website. It's martindörsch.at, as you see it over here. I think I can also do it a little bit bigger if I use Alfred. So here's my website if you want to come over and check it out. I'm a trainer, I'm a photographer, and I teach at LinkedIn Learning. Here I have over 66 trainings in language of German. But if you go to my YouTube channel, it's also Martin Dörsch at YouTube. You can also find some English tutorials about software, about pro photo stuff and photography in general. Okay, so that's some stuff about me and the introduction. I want to thank in the beginning also X-Rite for this webinar and phase one that we can demonstrate how to work with the color checker passport and how we can integrate the creation of ICC profiles in our workflow here now with Capture One as well. So let's start. Okay, you see I'm here now in Capture One and I want to start with some general stuff and some stuff are around the shortcut thing. So I just minimize the viewer. The shortcut for this is Command Alt V or STRG Alt or Option V on the Windows machine so that I see all the images. And today I want to demonstrate the workflow and how I work on more than one image. And in the end, because I saw it now, we also have a coupon code for some exciting stuff around Affinity Photo and X-Rite equipment. Okay, so let me start in the beginning, and I want to demonstrate you just for some with some basic adjustment how you can work on more than one image. And one thing I want to start or I want to show is how you can select or pre-select images. And one really crucial thing is the Show Focus Mask icon here. I give it in my toolbar. So you can right-click the toolbar to customize it. And then you can drag the focus mask here over. And what this thing is doing, if you press on it, you see an overlay. And where it's green in my case, you see where the focus was set or where the images are sharp. So here, say it's not that sharp. So I can reject this image. I had a shortcut for this to flag this image with red. Or if I go through, I see, I really see quite fast where the focus is okay and where not. Here, see a TIFF image. This was something I tested before. On TIFF image, it's not working. So also if I go to a bigger view, you also see the focus mask is here and I can really fast check if the focus of the shooting is right or if the camera was a little bit in the back or in the front. So quite a handy feature just to go through the images, to select them and to find images that's not that sharp like this one, because I demonstrated this before. You see it with the focus mask just in 1 second. Also, if you hide the viewer, just where all the images are like here, I will also mark this at unsharp, maybe this one as well. And so I can go through these images quite fast. That's really a handy feature I don't want to miss. Okay, so I go to the beginning of the images and start by by some basic adjustment, as mentioned before, I take the second image and just want to go to this image over here, or this image. So I have selected with the shift key this row of images, and now I can work on them. And the cool thing is that I have the possibility to see the images big, or just one image of the set big, or I can also toggle with this icon, so I see a multiple view of the images, and now I can work on them. So in the beginning, I just want to change the exposure. So I just take this image over here, just take the exposure up a little bit, and you see here in Capture One, you just work on one image. That's not a bug, that's a feature. Even if other images are selected, it's more or less a safety feature, I would say. And now you have the possibility to just select or to just choose which images or which properties you want to change or to alter on these other images over here. If I want to go and select all of them or everything I did, I just will pop up the shadows as well over this. Maybe I will give on a little bit more brightness or in the midtones and just decrease the saturation. And now I want to synchronize everything. I can go over here to this button on the top right and click on the copy button. So all the images or all the properties get copied, the adjustments, and then I can just insert the properties over here. So that's the mouse way, I would say. If you want to do it a little bit faster, I will just go with command C one step back. If you want to go a little bit faster, you can go in and work with some shortcuts. And because I always work with shortcuts, I don't find them now in the toolbar. So I want to copy the adjustments is over here, and the shortcut is listed on the right side of the menu item. And there's also a cool feature in the new version of Capture One. The shortcuts and the menu items are quite similar, or more or less similar, in the Mac and in the Windows version. So if you work on one or the other, or on both simultaneously, you can have the same shortcuts, the same menu items, and yeah, that's really, really streamlined. Okay, so I will copy them, Command Shift and C, and then I can go in and press the shortcut Command Shift and V, and all the settings get synchronized, and that's even a faster way. So undo, and the last one, it's over here. It's copy and apply adjustments, and I give a custom shortcut for this. It's here in the Mac, the Control and the S key. This shortcut is not a standard shortcut, and you can go in to edit, and you want to edit your keyboard shortcuts, just press on it. And now also here in the new Capture One, you have more options for this. You can search for command and you can search for key. So if you know you have a specific keystroke and what's the shortcut for this, you can go in and say Control S in my case, and now see adjustments, copy and apply adjustments, or the other way around. You can say, okay, just copy, and the keyboard shortcut editor dialog just lists you everything with copy, and I want to copy and apply my adjustments, and my shortcut for this is Control S. I close this because now I can go in and say Control S, then the dialog with the adjustment clipboard pops up, and there I can just press the enter key or click here on apply, and everything is applied. Yeah, just moment, just without any hassle. Let's say it in this way. So just for some other set, I will scroll down or just make this a little bit smaller over here. I will take the images from here to here because that's more or less the same situation. A big viewer, maybe, yeah, I would go in and adjust the image in this size, and there I would go in and take from the background the tint of the white balance and make it a little bit warmer. Then I go into the exposure tab and just will set the exposure a little bit lighter. Just go in with the shadows, and maybe I will also go to the curves. And here in the curves, really, really nice. You can have a Luma curve and not an RGB curve, where you go in and edit the RGB simultaneously. Here with the Luma curves, you just work on the luminance of the image, and that's quite handy because you don't alter any colors. and I can bring the classic S curve over here if I want to. And now just go in that you see it, Control S, enter, and you see everything is synchronized over your selected images. So I would also say just have an eye on how much images you have selected, because you have all images by accident, you will synchronize everything you did here over to all images. Okay, so I will go in with this image and just put on a little bit of an classic look if you want to. I will pump up the black points a little bit over here and just decrease the light point over there a little bit. And another nice and handy opportunity to sync is not via the adjustment copy and apply adjustments command. You can just go in and synchronize one tool by a time. So I just want to apply this over to every other image and it's done. So that's this small handy icon over here. You can just adjust or synchronize one tool, and that's quite nice. Okay, so just to the beginning. If you want to have a before and after, you can press on this small, I call it the recycling button. And the crucial part on this is you hold down your Option or Alt key. And if you press and hold, you see a before and after, before I press and let the mouse go, before and after, and then you see what you have done. If you want to reset everything you have done, you can just press here on the reset button, just without the Alt key, or you can also go in and take the shortcut via Command and R. Okay, so just some basics in the beginning. And now I want to demonstrate you the way how to work with the new Color Checker software and with the Color Checker here in Capture One, and how you can create your own profiles. And that's really a feature I was waiting for, and I'm quite excited that it's now here inside Capture One. In the beginning, I just want to say some basics. If you have a nice screen and you can trust your screen, for example, you have an Aizu or Benku, some hardware calibrated screens, then it's not that crucial that you calibrate your images. You can just go in and adjust the images to your liking, because your screen shows you the truth, and that's a really, really nice way to work with colors. But if you have the thing that you're working with two different cameras, or you have some other photographers this where you get your photos, for example, you have a second shooter at the wedding or so, then you want to have a profile for every camera that was used in your shoot, because you can have the neutral point in the beginning with this profile. And on this neutral point, you can build up all your style and everything you want to have or you want to have done with the colors. And how you create such profiles is the topic of the next few minutes. Okay, so that's really, really crucial. Just follow all these steps really step by step, because it's important for the profile creation. Okay, the first thing is you want to go into the curve, and the curve is here set to an auto curve, and the auto curve is not the best one. So go in and take the linear response. And the second thing is that you want to have in your ICC profile the profile under effects, and here you have no color correction. So that's the really two very, very important steps, because you want to have an as neutral image as possible and a more neutral starting point for creating the profile as this one isn't possible. So really under effect at the ICC profile, go in and take the no color correction profile, and under curve, you take linear response. So that's the two things you want to have with your color checker here in Capture One. And now that's everything here for now in Capture One. And you want to export your images. So I go over to File and export my image. I will check if I just have selected this one image. That's okay. And now I want not to export the originals, because the original is the raw file. I want to export my variants. So I click on this and I will export it to my desktop. And here are the good parts, or the parts you have to consider. You want to export as TIFF file, as uncompressed TIFF file, and also here you want to embed the camera profile. And the camera profile now is my no color profile. It's a little bit misleading, but trust me, that's the way to go. And normally you would go in with 16-bit. By now I have some issues with 16-bit and the color checker beta software is crashing on me. So I will go out with 8-bit, but 16-bit has more renditions and is quite better on the bit depth for sure, because you know everything 8 by the power of 2, for no, other way around, 2 by the power of 8, it's 265 renditions in this TIFF file by me, or now for me. If I had the chance to take the 16-bit, you see I would have over 65,000 different steps in my image. But as I mentioned, by now I have some problems with the 16-bit version, so I have to take the 6-bit version, the 8-bit version. If you do it, or the new software here, you can take the 16-bit for sure. Okay, so if it's okay, I can export this variant. You see here the export, it's done. I can press okay. And now I will close Capture One, because if I create the profile here with the Color Checker Passport software, you have in the end close Capture One nevertheless. So drag and drop, just drop this TIFF image that I just exported, and you see Capture One. No, I'm not in Capture One. You see the Color Checker Passport software in the ICC tab just recognized my target. I was a little bit on the dark side when I did the shooting, so I would recommend to do it a little bit lighter if possible, but I will just take it with this one and press on the create profile button. The profile's destination pops up. That's the standard destination here on the Mac. It's in the library, ColorSync profiles. That's also pre-populated. So I can just press on the save button and my ICC profile will be created right now. It's just a matter of seconds. And after it's done, the software will say, hey, you have to close Capture One, because Capture One just want to have the profiles loaded at the restart. I've done this, so I can go in to Capture One because it was closed and wait for it to come. And here it is. And you can see I have now the possibility to select the profile over here. So I will create a variant on this one just for fun, more or less. And here at the ICC profile, I can go into others and here see the profile I just created. This is the ILCE M7 or 7M3. So I shoot with Sony in this case and with the Sony M3. And here I will go to auto. And that's the profile I created with the color checker right now. So just for comparison, I go up to this image and go into the generic A7 M3 and also to auto, press on this one. So I have the two images next to each other. You see here on this camera, the standard profile is quite okay, but on the right side, you see all the colors are more saturated, more vibrant, and much more like the target. So a neat handy trick over right now, I press the shift key and hold it and zoom in a little bit with the pressed shift key. And now with the pressed shift key, I can also move both of the images simultaneously, and I can check the colors. And yeah, that's the right side is the image with the new custom built profile, and the left side is the profile with the generic profile. So that's quite handy. Okay, now I go in and hide my viewer like this and take this image, scroll down, let's say till here, because there I changed the light setup. And now I just go in and press the Control S key over on my side. And I just take the basic characteristic, the camera profile and the film curve, click on apply, and all the stuff, all the ICC profile generated or my generated ICC profile get synchronized on all of these images over here. So that's quite nice, I would say. Okay, and there you see it. That's the way how you can take your own profile. If you have more than one camera, as mentioned before, then now you can do this for this one camera, then for all the images of the other cameras or other cameras, and you have a neutral starting point where now all the colors you have over here, or in general, all your colors are as perfect as they could be, and all done with the color checker. And here also a small thing that you have in mind, there are two versions, let's say, on the color checker passport, and it's more or less a 2013 version and then the current version. I highly recommend that you take the current version and not the old one, because the color recipes changed a little bit. And if you take the old version of the color checker, then the colors don't match to the color checker passport software and your profiles are not that right. So really, really important that you have the current or the latest version of the color checker passport. Okay, there's an question regarding to this topic, and it's from Lex. So why it's not, why you have to convert the image through Capture One to a TIFF and not throw it inside the color checker software directly as raw image? It's more or less a good question, but actually I really don't have tried it. Let's try it. So I just reset this image over here, so it was out of the cam, and that's my raw image, and it's an RRV image, so because I shot with Sony. And if I go here and export this as variants, not as originals, then you will see I will take it with the DNG format, just throw it in. Okay, so wait for it. Here's my DNG, and I will drag and drop the DNG image. Maybe I close it over here. So now the DNG, and you see it's not working is with the ICC profile. If I would create an normal profile that you can use in some other software, let's call it Adobe software, then you can go with the DNG workflow. If you go for the ICC, you see you have to take a TIFF image by now. Maybe something is changing in the future. I really don't know it. So if you want to create ICC profiles, you have to go with the TIFF workflow right now. Maybe something is changing. I don't have any insights on this. I hope I have answered your question. Okay, where we have ended or have left. Okay, so in the preparation of the webinar, I also ask, so if you want to have some or if you have some special questions, and one really big question that pops over and over again is, can I show anything with Fuji files? And the answer is yes. I will demonstrate you, for me, the most important feature you can have with Fuji files. And I got some images from a good friend of mine, Ines Thompson, which is Fuji X photographer. And Ines just shot Rafa here. And you see, these are raw images. And what's the first thing that come up to your mind if you see that these are raw images out of camera? So this image wasn't edited in any way. Yeah, you see that it's black and white. And that's a really nice thing, because Capture One and Fujifilm partnered, or Phase One and Fujifilm, and now you have the possibility to go in and go with Fuji cameras. That's the important part. You can go in and go or read out the data on the Fuji film styles that's created or integrated in the camera. And you see it's in raw file, but I can go in and just take the Fuji film emulations. And if I want to have this, for example, in Fuji film classic chrome, I can use this over here. And you see I have a raw file. I have the possibility to check or to take the curves of the Fujifilm emulation that I want to use. And I have all the playing ground, the thing that's stored inside the raw image. So I can go in and just recover the highlights as far as I want. I have the possibility to boost up the shadows, and I'm really flexible in my workflow. I can use the Fujifilm film emulations, and I can work on raw images. Before, it was just possible to take JPEGs with the film emulations. Now I can go in and just select the images and take the classic Chrome, shift click on this one, and I have all the images with classic Chrome. And yeah, as mentioned before, all of these are raw images. So that's quite nice. A small drawback to me, I work with Sony. Okay, that's the point. But as mentioned before, that's a big thing for me with Fuji files. And for many people, it's also an thing with the Fuji files in an Adobe RAW engine, that you have this warmth over. That's more or less an sharpening issue and a noise reduction issue. Here in Capture One, nothing of this, and that's also quite nice. So now my few words on the Fuji stuff here in Capture One. So now we'll scroll down a little bit and just demonstrate you some cool things you can do here with Capture One to speed up your workflow. So for example, if you want to change the color, let's take this one. Let's take this one because I had some stars over here as well. And I want to change the color of the dress over here. Then it's not that important that you go outside the raw workflow into a pixel-based workflow. You can just say, okay, I want to go here in the raw workflow. I will just reset the image so we see it a little bit better, not with the look I created or this. And now I have the possibility to go inside my color tooltap. And inside the color tooltap, you have the possibility to go inside the color editor under the point of advanced. Just take this small color picker and pick this color. So, and now you see I have picked this color over here, and I can say just view the selected color range. And just with this one pick of a color, you see I have just selected this color range over here. And if I say that the colors are too strong, I can go in and pull down the saturations of this, or I can increase it. And I can also change the hue. So I can rotate the hue wheel and just go to a blue. If I want to go to some light blue, you just see I can go 30 degrees and not more. But if I take this color picker a second time and pick the color, so now I can rotate the hue even more, and I rotate it over to here. And that's really, really handy, because now I can change the colors. I don't want to go this drastic, so I take the saturation down a little bit. I think I also don't get the color right good in the beginning. Just take this one, and over here we'll increase the color as well. And the really nice thing on this is the following. I can go in and select some images. Let's say this one, and this one over here. And I have still this as my selected image. And when I press on this small icon here and apply these changes, or I will just hold the shift key if I want to go it or want to do it faster, then you see that these corrections get over to the other images. I will go in and just synchronize everything. So apply this, and I have my color change on these other images as well. And that's really, really nice, because now you don't have to select and redo everything. You just can go in like this. On this case, I will just reset everything and demonstrate this a second time, just to write or just to try it at home as well. So select your color, and there it is somewhere over here. So just double check which color you have taken. Maybe readjust a little bit. Slide your hue where you want to have it. Adjust the saturation, maybe the lightness, like this. And now you can go in with the hold down shift key and synchronize this over to all the other images that are selected right now. So that's quite handy. Okay, so that's a little bit of fast color adjustment. And now I will go inside and select some images to work in Affinity Photo because we want to see something or things that's possible. For me, it's so Capture One is the hands down the best RAW engine you can have. Affinity Photo is for the price tag and for the things you as photographer want to achieve. It's hands down the best tool, Affinity Photo. And both these tools, so Capture One with the really nice RAW engine and Affinity Photo with the really fast and fluent pixel editing capabilities, are a nice pack. And I want to demonstrate you right now what you have or what you can do with them. So in the beginning, I want to go in and just bring up the highlight, the shadows a little bit, maybe brighten this image as well, like this. And yeah, that's more or less okay. On the white balance side, I will just go in and take the white balance from here because I want to go to a more neutral point, but I will also bring in a little bit of warmth, or maybe I will do the warmth after the fact. So like this. Okay. And that's everything I want to do with the RAW engine or with the RAW workflow on this. And now I have the possibility to jump over to Affinity Photo. And I will right click on this icon over here. And there are two really, really important steps you have to understand. First of all, the edit with comment. And the other one is the open with comment. And in the beginning, you will say, okay, they are more or less the same because you can open it with Affinity Photo in both of them. But if you open the image with, for example, Affinity Photo, you will open the RAW engine or the RAW image. And in the RAW engine of Affinity Photo, but you lose everything you have done here inside Capture One. And because you want to have all the stuff you've done here in Capture One in your pixel-based image, you go in the first step with Edit With. And here you say Edit With Affinity Photo. And for editing this, you have to create a pixel-based image. So I will take a TIFF. I will take a TIFF with 16-bit. The compression options is ZIP. And the ICC profile is Adobe RGB because my ISO monitor supports Adobe RGB. And now I can say edit variants. And Affinity gets this RAW engine or other round. Capture One creates out of this RAW image and TIFF image. You see it right here. And this TIFF image gets handed over automatically here to Affinity Photo. And now I'm in a real pixel-based workflow. And what can we do here? We can do some retouching and I will demonstrate how to do this. And the really nice thing over there is that you can go to filter. And here in filter, you have an option for frequency separation. So the power of retouching, everyone wants to have frequency separation. So if you want to have it, you can have it here with Affinity Photo. And there you go like this. You want to have on the left side, on the high, where the pixel information is, you just want here to have all of the details, and on the right side you just want to have the color. And it always depends on your sensor resolution, it always depends on the size of your image. So the values I dial in are just for my image and for my sensor and for the size I have here. So it's, yeah, I will take something over here and press apply. And there you see you have a low and a high frequency layer. And with this low and high frequency layer, you can start working. So I will zoom in. I will go inside the low for the beginning. Take a lesser with a feather of, yeah, let's say 40 pixels or so. And just go in here and take the skin on the low, because here it's just the color, and go into blur and just blur it a little bit with the Gaussian blur, something like here. Then I will take the skin over here, something like this. Right now I'm working on an Cintiq tablet, so that's quite an succession, no, quite an handy tool for retouching. So Gaussian blur like this, apply. And because I have skin over here as well, I will go in like this. And here I will take just the same settings for the Gaussian blur as before. That's okay. And here the skin is okay. That's not an issue. Maybe a little bit over here, but I think nobody will see this portion. Okay, so that's on the low. Now I will go to the high frequency layer. And on the high frequency layer, I will go into the healing brush tool. That's over here. And with the healing brush tool, I can go in and sample just the current layer. I press the align button. And if you're working with a Wacom tablet, you can go into the more options on this tool and just switch over to the dynamics. And here in the dynamics, you have the possibility to set a size jitter and to set the mode from none to pressure. And that means that if I go in and just press light on the stylus, then I just have a small brush. If I go in and press a little bit harder, I will have a big brush. And there you can go in and do your retouching. Maybe I shouldn't be that fast and that bad over here. So let's take it like this. And with a little bit more feeling, wouldn't be bad. Yeah. So let's say that's okay right now. So then here a little bit. And I just don't want to bore you out with some recharging stuff over here, just so you see what you can do. Okay. And for sure, you can also always go in and create a new empty layer. Then you have to change your healing brush tool to current layer and below. And then you can just do all your regular retouching without going in and taking the frequency separation layer. Because now I have to watch the time a little bit. Oh, it's bad right now. But I think you know where you have to go. So that's the point where you have to switch on music and just take your time and go in and retouch a little bit. But for now, I think you get the idea. So if I want to have some more light or change the light inside the colors a little bit, you can go in and just create whatever adjustment layer you want to have. I will go in with the curves and lighten everything quite drastically. Then with Command I inverse the mask. With the B key, I go in and take a brush. Control Option left for the size. That's yeah, the size. Then I go with the X key to white and just lighten the eyes quite drastically. And because I work with an adjustment layer and an adjustment layer curves, I can go in and take this point and just lighten it to my liking. Something like this, for example. And if I uncheck this and check it again, you see how I did. On this eye, it's a little bit too bright, so I take a brush, make it bigger, take the opacity down to 20, and just one, two, three strokes over here. So the left eye, or our left eye from our view, is now a little bit darker. Okay, so a little bit of retouching and now liquefying. Liquefying is also quite an important step. So I take the Control or Command Alt Shift E shortcut, like we know it from Photoshop as well, and have a new layer with everything on it. And now we can change the persona from the normal persona over to the Liquify persona. And here inside Affinity Photo and inside Liquify, I will take the fourth tool, and that's the Liquify Push Left tool, shortcut L. I will take down the opacity, don't show the mesh, and now I can push the pixels to the left. So if I go here, one, two, it's a little bit on the fast side or on the fast way, So I go in like this and reset the mesh. So that's better. So a little bit over here and over here. Just take some small brush strokes like here. There go upwards like this. Okay. And I think that's quite okay here. 1, 2, 3. And that's okay. So that's also quite handy to liquefy here inside Affinity Photo. Okay, and now we want to bring back all the things we have done to Capture One. And because I entered Affinity Photo via TIFF, I just have the possibility to press Control or here on Mac Command and S to save. Affinity asks me, hey, do you want to save this image as TIFF file? Yep, save with layers. Don't use save as because then you save as an Affinity Photo document. You want to save as layers. And just wait a moment. The image gets exported. That's a good point that you made it right. You want to export out of Affinity Photo the TIFF file. And after the export has finished, you see the capture, or you see inside from Capture One that you have the retouched image. So I go over to Capture One. Now you see nothing. Why? Because I'm still on the raw image. If I switch over to the TIFF file and make a double click so that the preview gets generated. So just wait for the preview to get generated. Then you see, chuck, here's my retouched version of this image. And that's the important stuff. So I go back inside Affinity and close this image, just Command W. Now I don't have to save it because I changed nothing. And if I want to change this, maybe I want to bring back add something or bring back the liquify layer or whatever. Now I have the possibility to go with a right click on this icon. And now I don't want to edit it like before. Now I really want to open this image because I just want to open this TIFF image as it is on the hard drive. So I want to open this TIFF with Affinity Photo. And now this TIFF image gets loaded here in Affinity Photo and all my layers are here. Just for sake of demonstration, I will hide the liquify layer, save this document, wait for it to get exported, and then you see you have the image again in Capture One. So close it over here, switch back to Capture One, wait for it that it gets rendered. That's quite important. But I have here the raw image and over here the TIFF image, and when I put them side by side and with press down shift key and shift and dragging, you see here the unretouched version and here over the right the retouched version. And that's just with a little bit of frequency separation, a little bit of Gaussian blur on the low frequency layer. I would recommend definitely to take more time on the high frequency layer because then you have really, really nice results here on the TIFF file. But I think you know what to do. And the best thing over this is because I have a 16-bit Adobe RGB TIFF file here in Capture One, I can go in and work here with Capture One. I can do everything I want to do with this file. Can go in and make it black and white, and I can work with it and just say, okay, this is a little bit lighter, and this one a little bit lighter as well, and go in and bring up the shadows a little bit, and maybe inside the curves, I will bring up a little bit more contrast and go over to the details. And here in the details, I want to have a film grain and silver ridge, more impact. Let's go in and zoom in for this. So, and just work on this file as it would be an raw file. And all the settings I just made, I can also copy, Command-Shift-C, and go into a just regular file I've here and paste it, Command Shift V, and it's totally up to me if I work on TIFF or on RAW files. I just have to remember if I want to edit it. Now I have to open the TIFF file and not edit it. But on the other hand, if I want to have all this this grain, all this contrast, this black and white look, then I have to edit it with Affinity Photo. I get a second TIFF file and can work with it. So that's everything you want to have. The other question from Elias, the TIFF file for sure is saved inside the same folder. So you can go in with a right click on this one and say show in Finder. And somewhere my Finder image pops off on another screen over here. You see that's the raw image. This one is this file over here. And beneath this or on the beneath here or right next to it, you see the TIFF file. So if you go with TIFF and save TIFF with layers, then it comes inside your original file. If for some reason something went wrong, you can always go inside this the library and right click on this folder. And here you have the possibility to synchronize this folder and the TIFF image will be recognized and you have it back here inside Capture One. Okay, so that's really the important step. If you go out of Capture One, inside Affinity Photo, work as TIFF, 16-bit Adobe RGB, save it, come back, and you have the TIFF file over here, and you can work like it's an totally normal RAW file, and it's inside your workflow. Okay, and speaking of workflow, I have some minutes left, and I want to demonstrate you, I think, one of my favorite features here in Capture One. Yeah, there are two favorite features, maybe I have to demonstrate you two favorite features. First of all, I will just go in and say I want to export the images, and there I want to demonstrate you. I will just take this one I've worked on if I find it right now. This one, and maybe I'll take the second one. So if I want to export these images, then normally we have much too much information because we have 24, 50, 100, 150 megapixel. And we just want to deliver this, let's say, on the website. And there we have the possibility to go in and process these images. And I have a recipe, JPEG, sRGB, 1200 pixel plus sharpening. That's German Schärfung. And here I have the size on the long edge here, 1200 pixels, and on this long side, yeah. But the really nice thing are the adjustments. And here I have the sharpening and the output sharpening. And if you take the slider and slide it around, you don't see much. But if you go up here to this classes icon, this recipe preview, I think it, no, recipe proofing, yeah. Then you see the current size of your image. So if I just take this one and press this, that's the size of the image. So I take the proofing preview and go to 100%. So like this, then I have the one by one view on this one. And for example, if that you see it a little bit better, I will go in and say, okay, I want to have 600 pixels on this one, not the 1200. Then you see you have now the actual proofing view with 1:1. And that's really, really crucial because now you can change, see how the output sharpening really kicks in. If you just go in and throw the amounts somewhere, you'd never see how the amount works. But now with the output proving or recipe proving, you really see how much are you sharpening your output image in regard to its size. And that's really, really a nice feature. I definitely love this. So I go to 1200 pixels again, and just don't do it this bad. So let's go like this. Okay, and when I have set it up, I can go to process, and these two images get processed over here. you see also the orange icon when it's processed right now. Okay, now it's great, it's ready. I can also go in and select these two images. I can go out of the preview because now it's okay. And just press the shortcut Command D for processing, and these two images get processed and are outside. And here's my output folder, and you see the images with 1200 pixels and my output sharpening as well. Okay, a little bit of time. If you have questions, just throw them in so I can see them. Okay. And the second really nice feature, new from Capture One and new from Capture One 12, and quite handy for so much stuff, is the following. If I want to go to this image and I want to change, let's say, something with the light, I can go in and just go in and bring up the shadows. But you see, you don't have that much control what the shadows are or what you want to have the shadows to be. And you have the possibility to create a new layer with the plus icon. Because I have no time, I hold down and make it a little bit faster. You create a new filled layer, and this filled layer is for the shadows, for example. And inside this filled layer, you can go in and work with the luma range. And the luma range, basically, I will show you the mask. I have the mask set it up in green because I work much on skin tones, and green is much better to see than red, the standard red. And here I have the mask. And if I go in and take the luma range and display mask, I have the possibility to just say where this range of, or where is this layer should be on. And I just want to go to this dark regions. So just that you see it a little bit better, the two up icons over here is the range from, in this case, 29 to 100, roughly 100. And here the lower icons, or the lower small handles, are for the fall off. So you don't have this rough of an edge. But I want to start at zero. Go in like this, and I will smooth out this thing. Now I can apply it, and nothing has changed because I just have set it up the mask, or the region, like where the mask should be, should work. And now I can go in and bump up the exposure for this a little bit. I can go in with the shadows as well, like this, for example. Not as much, and with the brightness, take this back and just take the brightness over here. And I have this on this shadow layer. And here also, the cool thing, I can bring up all the other images and just go with Control S. In my case, I just want to apply this and click on apply. And now the layer, the shadows layer, gets synchronized all over the other images, and I have on all the other images this whole or the same adjustments I had on this one. Just because Capture One knows the image, knows all my settings, that's nothing I have painted, that's just by the numbers, so it works on every other image from the same lighting situation, if you want to, as well. And so I have it over here. Okay, now it's a little bit time for questions. And before the questions arrive, I will show you the 20% off code you can have on the xrightphoto.eu site with the code 1Martin20. That's my name, 1Martin20. And you can have from today till February the 10th, 20% off of all of these bundles, always in combination with a free Affinity Photo software. So I really can not much recommend this, or it's really crucial that you see that the potential you have with Capture One as RAW engine and Affinity Photo here in your workflow. And as mentioned, you get the free Affinity Photo if you just take, for example, an color checker passport. That's cool. That's really cool, because color checker passport is a tool I really don't want to miss in my workflow. So I will just let this stay over here and be looking to the question pod or to the chat pod. All the Lex asks, are these changes I made saved to the photo or to an XMP file like Adobe does it? No, it's changed. All these changes I made are stored inside the Capture One catalog if you're working with catalogs, or inside the session file, and you have it inside here. If you want, or why do you want to have it inside an XMP file? So if you want to work, for example, on another computer, you can always go in and take your library and bring it to the other computer, or you can also export stuff as catalog and import it again, and you have, yeah, you have a lot more, yeah, you have really a good amount of possibilities to work here in Capture One and Affinity Photo for sure. So if there are no other questions, I say thanks for your time. If you want to see more from me, just go over to my website. If you have some questions you want to write me, just write me an email, md@martindersch.at. And yeah, I hope I will see you soon, or you will see me. I hope I read you soon. And yeah, I hope it was something for you, because as I mentioned before, the combination with Capture One, now with the X-Rite Color Checker Passport, and with the pixel editing Affinity Photo, is really a great workflow optimization bundle. So thanks for your time, and have fun with your shooting and your raw images.